The Neanderthal was the first extinct hominin species ever discovered. In 1856, limestone miners excavating a cave in the Neander Valley near Düsseldorf, Germany, known as the Small Feldhofer Cave, unearthed the skeletal remains of a mysterious hominin. Although the bones bore a resemblance to those of modern humans, they were noticeably larger. The mine owner, Wilhelm Beckershoff, initially assumed that the fragments belonged to a cave bear and ordered them to be collected, preventing them from being discarded into a nearby waste pit. Eventually, these human remains found their way into the hands of Carl Fuhlrott, an enthusiastic fossil collector. Fuhlrott, a school teacher with a deep passion for geology, archaeology, and paleontology, like many young scholars of his era, examined the collection labeled as cave bear bones. Upon careful inspection, he realized without a doubt that these fossilized remains did not belong to a bear, but rather to a human. After news of this discovery spread through newspapers of the time, scientists from various fields began studying the remains unearthed in Düsseldorf. Until that point, the only known hominin species on Earth was Homo sapiens sapiens, and scholars of the time considered only two possibilities. Either the bones belonged to individuals who had been deformed due to disease, or they were the remains of a savage member of barbarian tribes that had once inhabited Europe, tribes frequently mentioned in Roman historical accounts. For instance, Hermann Schaffhausen, an anatomist and professor at the University of Bonn, analyzed the skeletal remains and, noting the extreme thickness of the bones, argued that they belonged to primitive European tribes. He believed that these early humans had developed large, robust muscles suited for the harsh conditions of their time. Even the renowned anatomist and evolutionary biologist Thomas Henry Huxley, in his 1864 book, Evidence as to Man's Place in Nature, described the Feldhofer Neanderthal skull as the most ape-like human skull ever discovered. He interpreted it as a crude and primitive form of humanity, and even proposed it as a transitional link between apes and humans. However, it was soon recognized that, contrary to Huxley's suggestion, Neanderthals could not be considered the missing link, as their skull structure was far more similar to that of modern humans than to apes. Other scholars, such as the prominent anatomist and pathologist Rudolf Virchow, a staunch opponent of evolutionary theory, and Karl Mayer, a firm supporter of the spontaneous creation hypothesis, conducted studies on the fossils in 1872. They claimed that the distinctive shape of the Neanderthal femur was due to rickets, which had caused an unusual gait. Mayer even speculated that the peculiar structure of the pelvis and thigh bones might have resulted from extensive horseback riding. Virchow went further, asserting that the right arm of this individual had been fractured and had healed poorly, causing chronic pain. He speculated that this persistent pain had led to the development of the pronounced ridges on the forehead. Ultimately, Mayer concluded that these were not fossils at all, but rather the bones of a Russian Cossack cavalryman who had fought against Napoleon's forces during the 1813 to 1814 wars. Amid the varying opinions of scientists regarding these fossil remains, the renowned Irish anatomist Professor William King put forward a groundbreaking idea. He believed that the fossil discovered in the Neander Valley represented a unique species within the human lineage, Homo neanderthalensis, with Tal meaning valley in German. However, in 1864, King revised his view, mistakenly reclassifying the remains as those of an ape man. Despite this misjudgment, he secured his place in history as the first person to recognize a new, extinct human species. It is important to note that the Feldhofer Cave Neanderthal from the Neander Valley in Düsseldorf, Germany, was the first identified specimen of this species, but not the first ever discovered. Years earlier, in 1829, a Neanderthal fossil had been unearthed in a site called Enghis in Belgium. and in 1848, another was found in the Forbes Quarry of Gibraltar. However, these remains had not been thoroughly studied or recognized for their significance. It was only after the discovery of the Feldhofer skeleton that scientists revisited these earlier finds and reassessed their importance. Further discoveries in 1866, including two nearly complete skeletons from Belgium, gradually convinced scientists that they were dealing with a distinct human population, one with skeletal and cranial features that set it apart from Homo sapiens. Eventually, they were compelled to accept William King's original proposal, officially designating this species as Homo neanderthalensis, Neanderthal man. The first reconstructions of Neanderthal appearance and physique were created in the early 20th century, following the discovery of the initial fossils. These early depictions often portrayed Neanderthals as brutish, unintelligent, wild, cave-dwelling beings covered in hair with exaggerated features based on their skull structure. However, today we know that these reconstructions, crafted by the scientists and artists of that time, were largely based on fossils of elderly and sick Neanderthals, leading to a distorted image of the species. For instance, the French paleontologist Marcelin Boule from the Natural History Museum of Paris played a significant role in shaping this perception. He reconstructed the face and body of a Neanderthal based on a nearly complete skeleton found in a cave near La Chapelle aux Saints, France, dated to 50,000 years ago. However, we now know that this specimen belonged to a Neanderthal man in his 40s, which, given that the average lifespan of Neanderthals was about 30 years, made him an elderly individual. This old man had lost his teeth, suffered from severe arthritis, and had broken bones that had healed poorly. Thus, he was hardly an ideal model for reconstructing the typical appearance and physique of a healthy Neanderthal. Over time, with the discovery of more Neanderthal fossils across the world, scientists were able to develop a more accurate understanding of their physical and cranial characteristics. A prime example of this shift is seen in the work of Carlton Stanley Kuhn, a renowned American anthropologist, who reconstructed a Neanderthal face but dressed him in formal clothing, complete with a freshly shaved beard and a hat. He even argued that Neanderthal facial features were not significantly different from those of modern Homo sapiens. In recent years, as scientific reconstructions of extinct hominins have improved, hair color, skin tone, and facial soft tissue have been depicted based on the physical traits of present-day indigenous populations from the regions where the fossils were discovered. However, elements of these reconstructions remain somewhat subjective, influenced by artistic interpretation and scientific inference. The Neanderthals are the best documented extinct hominin species to date. It is evident that, much like modern humans, they exhibited individual variations in their skeletal structure, differing from person to person and from one population or region to another. However, despite these within-species differences in skull and body structure, an overall distinct pattern emerges, one that is fundamentally different from the variation seen within modern Homo sapiens. All Neanderthals had large brains, with a capacity ranging from 1,200 to 1,750 cubic centimeters, comparable to, and in some cases even larger than, that of modern humans. Key cranial differences between Neanderthals and Homo sapiens include a longer skull shape, a low and receding forehead, prominent and arched brow ridges, a large nasal cavity, larger teeth, and a receding chin, all of which set Neanderthals apart from their modern human counterparts. In the next episode, on our journey into the past, we will discover where Neanderthals lived, how they spent their days, and what similarities and differences existed between them and us. So, stay with me.